Welcome back to the Data Professor YouTube channel. My name is Chinin Nantat Sen Ahmad, and in this video, I'm going to talk about how I would learn Python if I had to start over. And I know a few months ago, I created a video on how I would learn to code if I had to start over. But this video is a little bit different. I'm going to focus only on the Python programming language. And so without further ado, let's dive in. So this encompasses a four-step process. And we're going to start with identifying the problem. By identifying problems, I mean that you want to see and look around you what problems are there, particularly those that have data available that you could use as the basis for applying Python to solve. And you're probably wondering, why would you need to start with identifying problems? And so let me tell you about how I learned to code. So initially, what I did was open up a book or a tutorial video. And obviously, what you need to do there is to follow along. You'll probably use example data sets, like for example, the Iris data set, if you're learning data science or machine learning. And over perhaps a few months, you'll probably get tired of the same old data set. And so by selecting your own data problem, it will help you in your motivation to learn, to push through. Because what you're doing is you're problem solving data that affects you. So for my own learning journey, I used a biomedical data set that I had back when I was a university professor. And from there, I apply what I learned to gradually transform data sets, analyze it, build models, and eventually publish the findings. And of course, learning Python is no easy task. But by solving this particular data problem, the immediate value was that the resulting output directly translates to productivity, whether it be for publishing a research article, whether it be helping you make a better informed decision about the data set that you're working on, as well as, most importantly, the huge amount of time that you're saving because you're using Python to reiterate and perform redundant tasks in an automated fashion. And before proceeding further, let's take a step back and cover the important topic of what programming language to choose. And in the brief intro that I've given, I've hinted that I recommend choosing Python. And I know there's several other programming languages for you to choose, whether it be R, Julia, C. But for those starting out, Python is a great ecosystem that will allow you to do much more than just analyze data. You could build applications. You could, of course, generate beautiful data visualizations and plots. You could automate boring tasks on your computer. And most importantly, save the amount of time during analysis paralysis in trying to choose the best language to learn, whether it be R versus Python or Julia, as mentioned already. So choose one language and proceed further to the next step, which was to identify a problem to solve. And as I already mentioned, choose a problem will help you in your motivation to learn. The next step would be to build. You want to decide on how you want to take the problem, the data problem that you have, and what is the anticipated output. For example, in my case, I selected a health data set that comprises of several Excel files. And for my immediate end outcome, I would like to process the data set by accumulating, aggregating hundreds of Excel data files into a single file for a unified data analysis. And so I was able to do that with about 20 to 30 lines of code in Python, and it literally saved me about half a year's worth of time. And so talking about motivation booster. And so as you can see, you could apply the newfound knowledge that you have on the Python programming language to solve data problems. And another could be AI. You could use it to perform AI tasks. For example, you could use it for computer vision projects. You could create a small miniature form of a self-driving remote control car, if you like. You could build large language models, which has become quite popular these days. Or you could use it for natural language processing projects. So the two immediate types of projects that you could work on using Python is data and AI. And I know I've covered examples on healthcare dataset or biomedical datasets, but if you're coming from fields like finance or economics, you could also have those type of data to play with. If not, you could also play with your own personal data, whether it be you want to analyze prices from Amazon for items of your interest. Maybe you want to monitor the price. Maybe you want to compare the customer reviews of the products that you would like to buy. Maybe you want to analyze all of the job listings on Glassdoor. So for that, you probably want to perform web scraping. So now that we have already covered how you would apply what you have learned in Python to build projects, now let's cover the second half, which is the tools that will allow you to build projects. So obviously, one of the most popular questions that I get asked is, what computer, desktop, or laptop I would recommend? And so my typical answer would be, just about any computer that you have access to is the best computer. Because nowadays, you could make use of cloud computing resources. And so this brings us to the next one, which is to use Jupyter Notebook to play around with your ideas and data problems. And a free cloud version of that is the Google Colab. And a lot of my YouTube tutorial videos were made using Google Colab. And I've shared all of the notebooks on my GitHub. And aside from building projects in a Google Colab or Jupyter Notebook-like platform, I would also recommend to explore low-code web framework. And there's several of these. There's Streamlit, there's Dash, there's Gradio, PyWeb.io. And obviously one of my favorite is Streamlit. It's easy to use, it's quick to implement, and it's free to deploy, for example, on the community cloud from Streamlit. And I have already made several tutorial videos on getting started with Streamlit, whether in the form of YouTube videos or blogs. So if you're interested in that, I'll provide you some links in the video description. And the fourth tool that is a recent addition to my toolbox is ChatGPT. And I know there's several use cases for ChatGPT, whether it be for content creation or generating music, but a strong use case of ChatGPT, particularly to the field of data science, is you could use it to help you learn Python, to help you learn Python libraries. You could write a simple prompt like create a simple Streamlit application for importing Excel files and then creating a scatter plot from the first two columns. And automatically, you'll see that ChatGPT will generate the code for building that simple application. Or perhaps you would like to figure out what a chunk of code is doing. You could have it explain that in simple terms. You could have it refactor your code. You could have it translate from one programming language to the other. And I've tried that for converting it from JavaScript to Python. And so there's so many use cases, and I've actually created a playlist of videos on ChatGPT on how to get started. And so I'll provide you some links in the video description as well. And so let's now hop on to the next step, which is to learn. And there are two major types of learning resources. The first type is the free learning resources that are available out there. And one of my favorite is the one from Free Code Camp. There's several free coding certificates that you could take. And after completion, you have the job-ready skill to take it to the next step in finding a job, in working on freelance projects, or applying it to your own existing jobs. Aside from that, there's also the one from Kaggle Learn. It covers all of the important Python libraries for doing data science. And obviously, one of my favorite learning resources is YouTube. There are a lot of great YouTube channels that will help you to learn Python. You get to look at some of the coding tutorials or coding walkthroughs from these videos. And the second type of learning resource are the paid ones. And there's several of these. There's Udemy, there's Coursera, edX, and there is a new cohort-based platform called CoRise, which also provides training on various topics pertaining to coding and data science. And one of my favorite and a very cost-effective way of learning is Medium. Medium is a blogging platform where for the price of $5 a month, you'll be able to learn about various topics, whether it be about coding, data science, AI, how to use various Python libraries, how to level up your software engineering skills, etc. And I also blog on Medium as well. And in fact, if you decide to sign up for Medium, I'll provide you the link in the video description as well as in the pinned comments. A third learning resource are books, and there are free and paid books available. So let me show you. So these are some examples of the books that I use for doing data science. There's the one from Andriy Burkov, the 100-page machine learning book. There's the one from Tyler Richards on getting started with Streamlit for data science. There's the one from Nathan George on practical data science with Python. There's the one from Sebastian Rastka, UC Liu, and Vahid on machine learning with PyTorch and scikit-learn. And a similar book from Aurelien Geron on hands-on machine learning with scikit-learn, Keras, and TensorFlow. And I have several other books not mentioned already, but choose a book that you think would help you in learning Python. And in no time, you'll probably have a small library of these Python books. So let me know in the comment down below which are your favorite Python books that you use on a daily basis. All right, so let's move on to the next step. When you're learning Python, when you're building projects, I'm pretty sure that you'll probably encounter some errors and you get stuck on them. So here are some of the ways that I use to get unstuck. So obviously what you wanna do is you wanna copy the error message and then you paste it into Google. And then you probably come up with some search results from Stack Overflow or from forums of the relevant Python libraries that you got stuck in, or some articles written on FreeCodeCamp. There's also another way. You could paste the error message or the entire Python code in ChatGPT and ask it to figure out what are the potential solutions to the error. You could give it the Python code and you could tell it that you have encountered, and then you paste the error message in there. And oftentimes, it'll come up with a pretty good solution to that that will help you to debug. So being able to problem solve, troubleshoot errors is one of the most important part of learning to code in Python. Who here has never encountered any errors? Who here has never got stuck? I know I have countless of times. And by getting unstuck, the more times that you get unstuck, the better you become. Because at a future point in time, when you encounter a similar error, you'll be able to solve that with no issues. All right, and so let's move on to the next step, which is content creation. And so you're probably wondering, what does content creation have to do with how to code in Python? And for me personally, it has a lot to do with learning Python or just about anything. And so what I recommend, or what I found to be useful for me, is that when learning something new like Python or a new Python library, it often helps that you take the newfound knowledge and then you resynthesize the knowledge in your own wordings, perhaps by creating a tutorial on YouTube or as a blog on Medium, or even help out others on Stack Overflow or in the forums. And by doing so repetitively, you get to materialize the newfound knowledge that you have. And so the more that you resynthesize the knowledge that you have gained in your own wordings, the faster you'll learn, the faster you'll be able to move on and level up, and the better that you'll be able to retain the newfound knowledge about Python. And so let's move on to the next step, which is to network with others and to build in public. And so how do these two relate? So when you're learning something, and as I've already mentioned, you want to write about it as a blog or as a YouTube tutorial video, you could also build projects, share your GitHub repo, and then tweet about it. Tweet about the projects, tweet about the errors that you get and how you solve them. Share your solution to the world. Write a tweet thread if you like, and sharing your insights on how you solve that particular problem. It could be some topics like, here are 10 tips and tricks on how to use scikit-learn to build robust machine learning models, or any other topic that interests you. And by sharing that, building that in public, sharing your projects, you'll also receive feedback that will be valuable and that you could apply to your project. So it's always helpful to get some fresh eyes on what you have spent time on building. And oftentimes, these fresh eyes and fresh perspective will greatly add to the value of the project that you're building. And in addition to that, to networking in public, to building in public, it is also to participate in various challenges. And there are several great challenges on social media, like the 100 Days of Code, the 66 Days of Data from Ken G, and also the 30 Days of Streamlit challenge for learning how to use Streamlit. Also, let me know in the comments which other hashtag challenges that you think are helpful. And so the final step is to repeat. Rinse and repeat everything that I have already mentioned, where you start from choosing the language, identifying the problems to solve, whether it be for data or AI. Then you want to build, and then you want to learn, and then you want to take the errors that you have got from building projects in order to problem solve, and then you want to create content so that you could materialize the newfound knowledge that you have gained, and also to pay it forward by helping others. You also finally want to take part in social challenges, network in public, build in public, and finally, you want to rinse and repeat. Doing it over and over again will help you to master all of these steps. So the more you do, the more repetition, the better you'll become at it. And so I hope that this video was helpful to you. And let me know in the comments section which other learning approaches that have helped you in learning to code in Python. And as always, the best way to learn data science is to watch the Data Professor YouTube channel. And please enjoy the journey.